So we've already talked about the basic organization for a cache and what leads to cache misses. I'll now spend some time in this video discussing some innovations to reduce cache misses and also tolerate the miss penalty when misses do happen. Okay, so the first technique is cache compression, which is a very intuitive idea, right? What it says is if you have a block of data which occupies 32 bytes, if you were to apply some kind of compression algorithm and bring it down to say 16 bytes, then you have room in the cache to accommodate more blocks, and that should reduce your miss rate. Okay, there is a penalty, which is that every time you access the block, you have to spend some time decompressing the data. Okay, and there are other issues as well, such as the fact that each block is now going to have a different size, so it becomes harder to organize blocks in cache and locate blocks when you're looking for them. So because of these complexities, most commercial processors don't actually implement cache compression. But then on the other hand, you have a simple technique like a victim cache, which is used in many processes. Okay, so let's understand what a victim cache does. So if I have an L1 cache, which is say direct mapped or just two-way set associative, then this L1 cache tends to have a fairly high number of conflict misses. Okay, because there is an unusual amount of competition for say maybe one or two sets, and so those sets end up experiencing a fair number of misses. What a victim cache does is it says that when a block gets evicted out of L1 cache, I first place it in this victim buffer. Okay, and this could be something that has say 8 entries. And so I'm essentially giving every block some additional time to stick around. The hope is that this block got evicted because of conflict for a given set, and this block will again be touched in the near future. Okay, and when I'm looking up this buffer, I'm looking up all of the entries over here. And at the same time, I'm looking up, say, one or two entries in the L1 cache as well. Okay, so the victim cache is looked up in parallel with the L1. And if I'm lucky and I find data in the victim buffer, it avoids me having to go all the way to L2. Okay, so this victim buffer is basically a fully associative structure, because the block that I'm looking for could be in any one of those 8 entries, and so I have to search each one of those. Okay, so the victim buffer in this case is essentially providing at most 8 additional ways for one particular set, because it's saying that for that one set that has so much competition, in addition to the 2 blocks that are being accommodated in L1, I could also have 8 other blocks that all map to that same set, right? And all of these can coexist in the cache, and they can all yield L1 cache hits. Okay, so that's what the victim cache is trying to do. It is trying to selectively provide more associativity for a few sets that might have high competition for them. Okay, next let's look at replacement policies, and this is a topic that has received a lot of attention over the years. Until now, we've assumed an LRU replacement policy. What it says is, the ways in a set. So in one set, if I have 8 ways, those ways are essentially organized based on recency. So I'm keeping track of which way was touched most recently, which way was touched after that, all the way until the way that was touched least recently. Okay, and so now when let's say that I touch a block over here, this block then gets moved to the front. It is marked as being MRU, and everybody else over here shifts by 1 to the right. Okay, when I don't find a block in cache and I have to bring it from the lower level, the question is, which block do I replace to make room for this new block? What is usually done is that the least recently used block is evicted, and the incoming block is kept in its place. And then I have to reorganize my recency list and say that, this block that was just brought in has to move all the way to the MRU position, and everybody else shifts one place to the right. Okay, so this is how caches are usually organized. Blocks are placed into ways, but then I have this logical organization, which is essentially maintaining a recency list and keeping track of which block was touched most recently and which block was touched least recently. Okay, now if I have a two-way cache, it's very easy for me to implement LRU. I just need one bit. If this bit is set to 0, it may indicate that way 1 is most recently used. If the bit is set to 1, then it may indicate that way 2 is most recently used. Okay, so it just takes a single bit to implement LRU. If I have an 8-way cache, it's much harder to implement LRU, because now what I need to do is actually maintain this linked list. I need to say that, that way number 3, for example, was touched most recently. Coming next in the list is, way 6, then way 4, way 1, and so on. Okay, and it takes, 24 bits to implement true LRU, because I need 3 bits for each entry in that linked list, and there are 8 elements in that linked list. Okay, so, now you can see that it becomes, fairly hard to implement true LRU. Every time a block is touched, you have to update this list, which involves, reading and manipulating these bits and so on. Okay, so true LRU is complex enough that most processors don't do it for highly associative caches. Instead, what they do is something like pseudo LRU, where you maintain a tree. Okay, so you basically say that, I'm going to take all my ways, split it into two halves, right? So these are ways 0 to 3, these are ways 4 to 7. Okay, and I'm going to keep one bit which says, was the right subtree touched more recently, or was the left subtree touched more recently? Okay, and then you can continue this and say that even these are broken up into two. Again, I have a bit that keeps track of whether the right subtree was touched more recently or the left subtree and so on, right? So you can keep partitioning this and have a tree. And so when you're trying to locate a block that is least recently used, you navigate this tree to find something that has perhaps not been touched recently. Okay, but this is an approximation, right? Based on this heuristic, you might locate a block that might not have been truly LRU. All you can confirm about this block is that it's a block that has not been touched in, say, the last 3 or 4 accesses. Okay, but it is much more cost effective, because for an 8-way cache, all you need is, 7 bits to track this LRU information, as opposed to the 24 in my naive implementation. Okay, and there are other approximations as well. One example is NRU, which essentially keeps, 1 bit per block. And every time a block is touched, that bit is reset to 0, saying that this block has been touched recently, and I should not evict this block. If everybody is set to 0, then everybody is reset back to 1. And so for a while, the eviction policy is random. But over time, again, as some blocks get touched, you make a more refined decision, and you're careful to not evict something that has been touched recently. Okay, then I should just also briefly talk about a recent research paper called DRIP, which says that when a block is brought in, it should not be immediately placed in the MRU position, because there are many blocks that are brought into, say, the last level cache, which are eventually evicted without ever being touched again. Okay, so if you want to keep useful blocks in cache, what you should be doing is incoming blocks should be placed, kind of close to the end, not in the MRU position and not in the LRU position, but somewhere close to the end. And this gives the block a little bit of life in the cache. That block is going to be resident in cache for a little bit of time. And that block has an opportunity to prove itself that it is indeed really useful. And once it gets touched, it moves up into the MRU position and it's going to enjoy a fairly long lifetime in the cache. Okay, but if it doesn't get touched, it gets evicted pretty quickly and does not waste space in cache. Okay, so this is just an example of how people have considered all kinds of different heuristics to try and keep the most useful blocks in cache and evict the block that is deemed to be the most dispensable. Okay, so even with all of these policies, you will have cache misses, and how do you tolerate these misses? So the number one technique to tolerate misses is, of course, out of order execution, and we've already talked about this in depth, how a whole bunch of instructions are brought into the processor so that while one instruction is stuck waiting for data, you can at least make progress on other instructions that don't depend on that long latency instruction. Then the other technique is hardware and software prefetching. Okay, so your cache is never going to be perfect. You will have misses. But perhaps you can try to anticipate what is coming up next and bring it into the cache before it is actually requested by the CPU. Okay, and we've talked about software prefetching, where we said that I will move loads higher up in the program and I'll issue them speculatively. At the hardware level, you need structures to detect if there's a regular access pattern, if this is something that the hardware can anticipate and prefetch for. So the most common technique is called stride and stream prefetching. And I'll just walk through an example to show you how a stream prefetcher works. Okay, so for example, a given instruction in the program might be issuing these loads that have a very regular address pattern. Okay, so perhaps that load first issued a request for address A. Sometime later it issued an address for A plus 4, then A plus 8, A plus 12, and so on. Okay, so I'm going to keep one table over here, which is called a stride detector. And it says that, for this PC, this is what is being touched. Okay, so I first touched A right now. Okay, and after some time, when I touch A plus 4, I look in this table and say, hey, this PC just touched A recently. Okay, so accordingly, let me keep track of that. Let me keep track of the fact that I seem to be touching blocks with a stride of 4. And what I just touched is a plus 4. And I've seen, one example of this stride of 4. Then when I touch a plus 8, I again do a check and I say, it looks like I'm again seeing a stride of 4. So I'll increase this count to 2. Now I've seen 2 instances of this consistent stride. And what I touched most recently was a plus 8. Then I touch a plus 12, and so this becomes a plus 12. I make this number 3. Once this number becomes high enough, I can then say that, now I have high confidence that what I seem to be doing is walking along the stream of data with a consistent stride of 4. And so now I should actually trigger an entry in my stream prefetcher. So the stream prefetcher says that let's create an entry. I just touched a plus 12, so I expect that what will be touched next is a plus 16. So this is a stream with a stride of 4. And this in the stream buffer, this is called the stream buffer. And this is going to jump ahead and start prefetching the next set of entries. So I'll go ahead and bring in a plus 20, a plus 24, and so on, maybe until a plus 32. Okay, and then when the CPU makes a request for a plus 16, that hits in the stream buffer. So this services the request really quickly, gets taken out of here. That allows me to now prefetch the next element, a plus 36. And then similarly, when the CPU accesses a plus 20, this gets taken out. The stream buffer brings in the next entry and so on. Okay, so the stream buffer is always trying to stay a few steps ahead of the CPU. And you first need to detect a consistent stride. And when you do that, you then set up an entry in the stream buffer. And that automatically lets you bring in data well before of its actual use by the CPU. Okay, so I've shown you, how this is organized. The stream buffer is accessed in parallel with the L1. Okay, and you can make this, more complex. This is basically a finite state machine that allows you to consistently detect that stride. Okay, and then a few other things about prefetching. As I said, it introduces cache pollution if you bring in stuff that'll never be touched. And so usually having a separate buffer is a good thing because it eliminates this cache pollution. If you prefetch very aggressively, then you're bringing in blocks that might never be touched, but you're also increasing your chances that, most accesses by the CPU would have somehow been prefetched. So it increases your coverage, but you're also bringing in blocks that will never be touched. So your accuracy goes down, and that wastes memory bandwidth. It possibly wastes space in your cache or in your prefetch buffers. The prefetches must also be timely. If you prefetch too soon, then the block that you bring in may get evicted even before it's actually used. And likewise, if you prefetch too late, then you're not completely hiding the delay for that fetch from L3 or memory. Okay, so prefetchers have to be issued at the right time, and that's also an important consideration. Okay, so in the next set of videos, I will talk about large L2 caches, and then I'll move on to the topic of virtual memory.